It's the Business Move Podcast. It's Cliff. Of course, I'm here with
Big Homie Mac.
Hey, I told you it's summer. We're gonna keep it hot. Today, we're going to South Dallas, if I'm not mistaken. Trey Haggerty, everybody.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate y'all having me.
What's up, my brother? What's up, my brother? I so appreciate you coming to visit us.
Nah, for sure.
How the summer treating you?
Bro, it's amazing. It's amazing. I've been traveling, moving around. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Living life, bro.
You told me you just moved back home. You been enjoying it?
Yeah, what?
Yeah,
I love it, bro.
How I feel to be home?
Man, you can't beat it. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I know everybody like to go different places. I've been a lot of places, bro. So
ain't nowhere like home?
Nowhere like home. Man. Nothing like Dallas, bro. No, I don't care what nobody say. The food, the women, the money.
Yeah.
Everything is right here.
The slang,
everything, bro.
Look, well, let's get into what you just said to Dallas. I mean, when you think of your youth, I know if you've had a few interviews, like I said, this journey, and we're going to get into it. This journey has been a long journey.
Hell yeah.
Well deserved to the position that we are in as far as in the blessing we're receiving. But when you think of youth, let's start sonically. What are sounds you hear from that youth?
In Dallas or everywhere?
Just for your youth.
For your youth.
Like, oh, for me.
For you, growing up. But what are those sounds?
I was listening to Houston shit. I was listening to Big Mo. That was my favorite rapper at the time. Mm-hmm. A lot of Big Mo.
And
come on, bro, my mama loved it. That's all my mom was listening to.
Where your parents from?
Like, from Dallas.
Understood.
Yeah, my mom went to Kimball, so a lot of that, you know what I'm saying? And it went from Big Mo to, like, as you see all that, to Jeezy. Jeezy was my mama's favorite rapper. That's all we listened to is Jeezy. Come on, bro.
Air Force.
What?
All that.
That's all we listened to is Jeezy, Big Mo, and then from there, I kind of transitioned into my own lane, but those were kind of the inspirations, you know.
That's for the youth.
Yeah.
And outside of I guess Jeezy and those names, but let's dive into the culture as far as in Dallas. Do you remember? Because I remember, like, when I was younger, a lot of people, and you my age, I remember on the north, I grew up with a cat named Doughboy the Chef. He was signed to DSR.
Mm.
I remember Oak Cliff Hard Hitters.
Mm.
I remember who else was on DSR? This was Big Tuck and then was rolling.
Uh-huh.
You know, any names like that you could kind of remember from that time from?
Definitely Big Tuck, for sure.
Understood.
Niggas listen to Tom Tom.
There you go.
You know, man, I still give it to guys like the Row just for doing this thing in Dallas, bro.
That's heavy.
You know, Big Chief. Big Chief. You know what I'm saying? That was a household name out here.
Understood.
Toast to Big Chief, but he feel like he don't get his flowers.
Man.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
come on, I'm giving it to you, bro.
Yeah,
I'm giving it to you.
And I remember me coming up from where I'm from, and I'm like, this nigga, you know what I'm saying?
Hard,
so
hard.
Nah, for sure. So I just wanted to.
Nah, absolutely. Hell yeah.
What part of Dallas, though? Where we at? You just all over the.
Man, I rep Dallas as a whole, because you know what I'm saying? Like, people on the outside look like we don't really rep Dallas, so I want to say Dallas.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Every part of Dallas.
Understood.
Whether you from goddamn Arlington to goddamn Frisco
really
to goddamn wherever.
And for self, I mean, what was the culture like, I guess, just growing up?
Shit, bro, like, I grew up in Duncanville. You
Understood.
Know what I'm saying? Duncanville area. Went from Oak Cliff to Duncanville.
Uh-huh.
And people think, like, Duncanville, that's a suburbs, blah, blah, blah. You know how this shit go.
Understood, absolutely.
Bro, it's hood niggas in Duncanville every day. You know what I'm saying? Like, what? Come on, bro. I went to Duncanville. It was
hood niggas everywhere you
black
go.
Black people and Mexicans. You know what I'm saying? I don't even remember white people at Duncanville. You feel what I'm saying? But people think, like, oh, it's the outside of Dallas. Like, niggas ain't on that.
It's real niggas everywhere.
What? Come on, bro. I know in my neighborhood, we had real niggas for sure.
So.
You know what I'm saying? I grew up in the woods, so... You know, niggas know if you from that area, you kind of know what that is. But it's a lot of Young Nation from the woods.
Nah,
you know what I'm saying? Like, it's a lot of
niggas was
nah, hell yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So
heavy impact on the culture.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
So regular, you know, shit that people go through everywhere else, from South Dallas, Oak Cliff, East Dallas, all them places. We went through the same shit in Duncanville. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Like, poverty driven. This ain't no area where niggas just got money.
Not really.
Like, well, I think they kind of fuck it up when they feel like niggas is trying to make it out. Like, dang, you get what I'm saying?
Bro, I be seeing niggas say, like, oh, Duncanville and just all, that ain't Dallas.
No, I done seen a lot of shit going on.
Like,
what? What
niggas be talking about? Like,
not really.
Bro, Duncanville is Dallas. The Solo is Dallas. City is Dallas. All this thing is Dallas. Like, all this shit is Dallas, bro.
Understood.
Like, niggas used to go to the stadium.
Nah.
You know what I'm saying?
Come on, man.
You went to the stadium?
Come on, we friendly
city. Oh, come on, bro.
We friendly city for damn sure.
You know what I'm saying?
Like, yeah.
But where that come from? Like, were you just like, it's Dallas. You know what I'm saying? As a whole. Is that you just going around and just seeing and observing like everything going on? And yeah. I know you probably see a lot of the Dallas T out there in the world, and it's just like.
Yeah, man, because, you know, being from her, I don't want no separation. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to say, you know, Oak Cliff niggas, East Dallas niggas.
And it's heavy that you're saying that.
I want to rep us as a whole. You know what I'm saying? Because when we go to goddamn Atlanta's and all these other places and Houston's and,
understood.
You know, they say they from Atlanta. You know what I'm saying? So I'm from Dallas. Like, this, we doing that. I want to rep every nigga that's from Dallas. We going to do it in Dallas. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So, because we all been through the same shit. Like, niggas all went through the same clubs as a teenager. You know what I'm saying? Niggas was going to Lotus. Niggas was going to Skadium. Niggas was going to all these spots. So, no matter where you was from, you was doing the same shit.
So tell me, when does the music come about as far as the journey, I guess, for you? When was that first time? I mean, again, I know knowing the culture was a freestyling, just at the lunch table.
Yeah. I was doing music since I was like 12.
Hmm.
Yeah. One of my homies, KJ. KJ he had a little Fruity Loops on his laptop with a little karaoke mic. And he kind of just put me on to it, and we was just all just doing it every day, me and him, in the closet type shit. We'll put a sock over the mic, go in the bathroom,
and get to work.
Get to keep the reverb. Yeah, we need the organic reverb.
Get to work.
You know what I mean? So niggas was just doing that every day, bro. And then we just, but like I said, I was focused on football too and shit like that. So, you know, I was just perfecting it. I didn't put no music out. I didn't know where it was gonna go. You know what I'm saying?
But you always had a passion for it?
I always had a passion just for words, just understanding how to use certain words. And like I said, Wayne became my favorite rapper.
Hmm.
So I was trying to be Wayne, you know?
Hold on, let's freeze frame, because you said at that time you was more so focused on football. And more, I think the music was more so, more, I guess, a seed that was just planting where it was kind of just enjoyment at the time.
Yeah, it was just enjoyment, just an outlet, just to get shit out.
At that age, what was I guess, like the goals to life? What was, I guess, what were you thinking for future, for self? Did we have that plan at that time, you thought?
Yeah. So I played football, of course, but I never wanted to go to the NFL.
Talk to her.
I just wanted to get a scholarship. Yeah. That was my goal. Like, you know, my mom won't pay for school. So I was like, man, how can I pay for school? I'm going to play football. I'm going to get a degree that way. You know what I'm saying? That was the ultimate goal.
Did you end up succeeding that way?
No. But
I thought you did end up going to school.
No, I did. So I, you know, I did go. I played football in college.
Okay.
So I played in Nebraska. I had a full ride scholarship in Nebraska.
That's happened.
And then I transferred to Texas State and played football at Texas State.
Understood.
But when I transferred, I lost my scholarship.
Mm. Of course.
So at that point, I just took out hella loans.
Hmm.
And loaned up. Mm. So
you remember the amount?
40K. Hold on. Listen, this is no cap. Nobody know this. I am 40K in debt to this day.
Damn.
What?
This nigga. What? Real talk.
No, for real.
They got to kill me to
you
come
love
get
that
it.
Football, though.
Man, I do, for sure. Yeah. I grew up off that. You know what I'm saying? Like, I play for the Red Bull Raiders. I don't know people. You know, people in the hood know that, who that is. Like, I play for the Red Bull Raiders, you know, all my life.
Yeah,
and is that why the desire kind of left? Because you knew football wasn't basically the front page to your college career at the time?
I mean, I just knew, I was a thinker. I just understood, you know, I wasn't the biggest, I wasn't the fastest.
Hmm.
You know, I was good enough, so I knew I could go to college for it, but I knew I wasn't going to make it to the league, you know what I'm saying? So I was always thinking, okay, what can I do, you know? And how can I pay for college? But I'm still in debt, so.
you're good.
Hold on,
I want to stay at college, though. No, we got to stay, because, again, let's get somewhere. And I mean, because you just said something real heavy. You said you're a thinker. So throughout this process, I'm a thinker as well, sometimes overthinker. Sometimes we'll build off of something, again, that may be new.
Mm-hmm.
The direction can shift off of the information.
Yes.
So, again, once that direction shifts from leaving Nebraska to Texas State, correct?
Mm-hmm.
What does the mind take you after that 40K?
Yeah, after I got in debt and shit, I had always had a plan to be an engineer. You know, that was my goal. You know, I wanted to be an engineer, and it was an architect at that time too.
Understood.
But I was like, yo, how could I be? I'm gonna be real. It was like, how could I make the most amount of money fast? That was my goal.
Understood.
And engineering was it, because I could graduate in 4 years. get an engineering degree, make the most amount of money, and I want to move to LA. That was like my whole dream, you know what I'm saying?
Something that, for shit stuff.
So, and, well, this was music engineer. This is industrial engineer.
Oh, okay, okay.
So I'm in a suit and tie at a goddamn, yeah, this is a whole other shit.
Go a whole other motherfucking route.
So I knew that was the quickest way to get a lot of money. You know, engineers, they say engineers make this, that, at that time, that's what I was hearing.
Understand.
Like, shit, and I was good at math, you know what I'm saying? So I'm like, fuck it, I'm gonna be an engineer. And I'm, you know, and that's why I got into my whole philosophy of plan your work your plan will work.
Talk to him.
I had that plan since I was like 13, 12, you know, that play football, get a scholarship, get an engineering degree, move to LA. That was my goal.
That's heavy, boy.
Young.
Nah, cause he.
That's heavy, boy.
Like, this is what I want to know, cause I want to give somebody their flowers, bro, because you saying like this process as a young man, you knowing all this, where is that coming from? Where is that instilled at, a youth age? Meaning like, where is you just like, you know what I'm saying? Because there's a lot of these in Dunkelville that play ball that ain't thinking like that.
That's true.
So, where does that come from? It's like, is that just
your
upbringing? Is it mom? Yeah. Is it pops? Is it?
Is it just? Is it the experience around you? Is it life going around you that's making you shape yourself to being again that thing?
That's a good. I was just always like that. You feel me? Like,
yeah.
You know, we grew up with hood niggas and niggas that go to other routes and shit like that. So. You know, playing football for Reparators and just being in those environments, even with, you know, family, friends, and shit like that. It was always niggas around me that was on some, you know,
understood.
Trapping or whatever the case may be. They was on that. So I saw that. So I'm like, you know, I want to do the opposite. I want to do something else.
What I'm saying, like, at a youth age, like, who pushing you?
Niggas ain't thinking like that. That's
nobody,
what I'm saying.
Bro, okay. Is it you? Time, it was just me, yeah. I don't know.
Anyway, in the case niggas don't understand.
Real talk.
I don't know. I think you do. You gotta know. I know you know.
Maybe it was just God.
No, there you go. That's God. But hold on. To even, I hate
everything.
To talk like this.
Just maybe life.
Yeah, I hate to talk like it's over liquor. But that's what it is. And we're not gonna stay into this too much because, again, we're drinking a little liquor. But that's what it is. Not necessarily even God, but the God within you, bro.
Facts.
For us to understand that light and follow that light.
Yeah.
And that's what's heavy because a lot of times we'll get these explanations of life of why not. Why not? It's because we ignored it. And that's just simply so.
That's
you ain't ignore it, my nigga.
That's true.
And that's simple. You ain't ignore it.
Yeah.
But back to, well, hold on, was you saying somebody didn't interrupt you? I just had to drop that right quick.
I'm about to get somebody to give him his flowers, because that shit hard.
It's really creative habits. I mean, not even creative habits, but successful habits.
Yeah.
And before we leave college, I mean, because that timeline right there, again, from you saying 12 and 13 of having it, this mindset of this thinking pattern.
Yeah.
What would you say? I guess, would you say you had a sense of, well, I guess that is, of successful habits, I guess, planning?
From the beginning.
Yeah.
Like, I always made good grades. You know, I was always getting all A's. Like, everybody in school knew me. Like, I was popular, but I go hang with the nerds.
Absolutely.
You know, those were my people, too. You know what I'm saying? So I had already kind of, even though my niggas was a certain way, I still was over here doing what these people were doing, too. So I got to saw both sides of it. You know what I mean? So I guess just maybe through that. Through that lens,
experience,
I just got to understand, like, okay, I don't gotta do this to do this. You know what I'm saying? I can go over here, I can get good grades, I can go to college, I can get an engineer, I can do it this way.
Absolutely.
Rather than trying to,
get
you know, my
years.
Man, come on. Oh, my nigga still trying to, you know, play football at 40, you know what I'm saying?
Really, like, yeah. OG, chill out. You got to get that shit up, OG.
For real.
But real deal though. You got to sit. I say this all the time. You got to sit at different tables to get different conversations.
Facts.
And I think your youth, as far as being that type of individual sitting over here, where like we said, what would be like the lame or whatever it may be, get yourself these social skills now. And I'm sure when you go into these side of these rooms,
absolutely, it's different. I was in a band in sixth grade. I played football and was in a band. So I hung around football niggas, I hung around band niggas, you know what I'm saying? So I got to see, I'm soaking it all up, bro.
Soaking it
all up. Like,
let's get back on track, man.
Yeah, we on track.
No, real deal.
We on track.
But I ain't never told nobody I was in a band.
Hold on, what you play?
The euphonium. Yeah, it was like the tuba type of shit. Yeah.
Hold on. The euphonium. What do you mean?
It was like the smaller version of a tuba.
Okay.
Yeah.
Man, I wasn't in there.
Nah, no, okay. That's hard though.
You were in a band?
Nah, I wasn't in a band, but I love to play the piano. I love it. Don't give me that. Hell no,
never in school. Hell no, I wasn't.
But I grew up in the church though, so me being in the choir, me singing, but I always had a fascination from when I heard them drums, like that guitar, that piano, like that's like therapeutic.
Same.
I don't even gotta hear the music, but if I can hear like those chords, if I can hear those keys, I can hear them drum that do something for me. Nah, hell yeah, real deal. We don't do that.
Hold on, all right, fast forward.
No, I want the music.
Yeah, that's all done.
Yeah, what's the first project?
40K.
What's the first project that makes you say, let's do this?
Oh, some music shit?
Absolutely.
First project.
And not even necessarily like money made, but you say, hold on. You heard
it.
It
was called, damn, I don't even know. Oh, Lifer. Lifer.
Lifer?
Lifer something. Lifer Volume 1 or something like that.
What year is this?
2016.
Okay.
Lifer. Yeah, so in the beginning, you know, I wanted to call my fans lifers and just doing whatever you do for life. So my project at that time was called Lifer. That was like my first like official, like, yo, I do music. Here it is type shit, you know what I'm saying? And luckily I met a guy, his name is Ryan, Ryan Hudson, Big Hood. He was an artist out here. Shout out Big Hood. He heard the music and was like, yo, like, you dope, like, I wanna help you. Cause I knew nothing about nothing, you know, I'm still recording, goddamn. With a free loop mic, like,
yeah, you just getting through.
Yeah, what?
You just putting the work in.
Yeah, bro. So, bro, put me on. He was just like, yo, like, I want to help you. So, I got to understand a little bit more of what it looks like to be an artist.
Understood.
You know, he used to take me to the studio in the hood. You know what I'm saying? Where I used to just record there, and I recorded that project. And yeah, that was my first like piece of work type shit.
And at this time, because me listening to you, I mean, you have a few different ranges. You go where you kind of go into the melodic, but then you could rap.
Yeah, oh yeah, I can rap, yeah.
So what at the beginning, were you taking both those routes?
So, well, beginning, I was rapping. I wanted to be Wayne again, so I was, you know, rap.
Right.
But then, you know, throughout my career, I heard different artists, and my taste changed a little bit. So on that project, you know, probably listening to Travis Scott or all these different artists, I was trying to duplicate. Take what they were doing and try to perfect it, right?
Absolutely.
So that project, it was just like, just trying shit, bro. Like,
trying to find your way.
Just trying to find a way as an artist, yeah, because I didn't know, you know?
Especially with music, the music could be such the emotions within life at that time. Yeah. So like you said, that just might have been the vibe you was on.
At that moment.
Absolutely.
And still using like, and I still stick by this to this day. Whatever I do, I always still use words. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm never just, okay.
1, 2, 3.
Yeah, no.
1, 2.
I'm always thinking, okay, how can I creatively use this word and flip it or whatever the case may be?
Because
that's where I came from, rapping. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? So, that was the first thing.
You know, some Biggie shit.
Not real deal.
Yeah, for sure.
Real tough.
Yeah.
Just like, I'm listening to the music, even like the beginning. Me personally, I'm listening to like your newer music, and I'm like, bro, he kind of aiming more at like the women.
Oh yeah, bro.
Where that come, like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
some thing, bro. I always.
I dug in like 4 or 5 years ago, and I'm
Yeah, hell yeah.
Rap. And then I get the fast forward. I'm like, he aiming for a whole nother.
Bro, I tried everything. I didn't
understand your market.
I tried rap shit. I done tried pop shit. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure some of that's on there.
Mm-hmm.
I done tried EDM shit. I done tried. I was at this time, bro. I was just throwing, hoping some stick, like throwing.
Penny heavy,
man. What?
What started sticking?
Everything.
No,
everything was sticking in its own way, but it wasn't sticking together. You know what I'm saying? Like, and it got to stick together as an artist. So I drop an EDM song, people like it because it's me and it sounds good, but that don't mean these people like it. So I do a pop song, people like it, but.
Right.
These people don't like it, you know what I'm saying? So I might do a hard, like on some, I got a song called Bodies, like on some rage type shit, you know what I'm saying? Like mosh pit type shit. I do that, people like it.
Right.
But still trying to find my way through the music and figure out how can I be myself as an artist. Because I've always been, you know, I've always got girls, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. Girls have always been a...
And that's what I was going to say. Well, I guess what influences the adjustment is, like you said, just simply trying?
Man, to be honest, just...
Was that just where you at right now?
Yeah.
that's
where I'm at.
Real deal.
But just understanding how to just be myself. Because at first, I'm like, okay, let me make this pop shit to try to make some stick. I ain't really listening to pop music growing up, so I don't really know how to do it. I was just doing it.
Yeah.
Never listened to EDM growing up, so I was like, I was just trying it.
You feel like this you?
This me. This you know what I'm saying? Right? I didn't try to raise shit. I'm not I ain't got no dreads. I don't know how to dye my hair.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I ain't no.
You don't even want to do that.
I'm a Dallas nigga for real. Yeah, like, you know what I'm saying? So I'm like, bro, that's
Yeah.
I ain't doing that. So when it came to just making music for women, I'm like, oh, this is me. Like, I love the women. The women love me. You know?
Come on, bro. Them, you know.
Yeah, and I like to have women around me. Like, that's my environment. Like,
yeah.
So I'm like, bro.
Something I'm cater to you.
Yeah, let me cater to what I've been doing all my life.
You know, something else I got to come in you on as well, and I want to ask about is visuals. I see you. Mm-hmm. You have a few different people you work with, but there's no way you're not involved in some of these.
Oh, for sure, for sure, heavily.
Does the woman come laying?
Hold on,
I got you. We're at a table. It's a naked, beautiful woman, by the way, laying on the table, and you and another woman are eating off her.
Oh yeah.
Is that you?
Yeah, for sure. Bro, I come up with.
If you want to talk shit for my nigga, then he has another one. When he's in a dollhouse.
I had to give a
nigga his flowers.
That is crazy.
Thank you, yeah, I really took, what's the word I'm looking for? Pride in coming up with video ideas from the beginning of my career until now. Like, mm-hmm. I always directed my own videos. I always try to stand outside the box. When it comes to my freestyle videos, I don't even know if y'all seen that. Like,
absolutely.
From the beginning, I used to drop freestyle videos every month. You know what I'm saying? Just trying to make some shit pop. You know what I'm saying? But coming up with those ideas, I always try to stick outside the box.
Mm-hmm.
And then as I got bigger and bigger, my video ideas got crazier. But I understood when to be crazy and when not to be crazy.
No, absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? And my ultimate goal was always to direct videos for other artists.
Understood.
You know, outside of me, just, you know, starting up, you know, not a production team, but having my own production team. Kind of like DaBaby.
I was just finna say that.
He directed the video with Moneybagg Yo.
I seen him with the sexy red. You seen that?
Him and Tiana Taylor got
Tiana crazy, Taylor. That's a great example.
Crazy.
So having on the production team, actually just directing videos, that was another goal of mine. So
for sure.
So the sushi idea, yo, I sent the director. I'm like, yo, I want to have a beautiful woman on the table. I want to eat sushi off her. No ifs. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm not compromising. Let's do that.
How'd you pick the woman?
They picked the woman. Okay. Oh yeah, I didn't pick the woman, but I was like, and I sent them pictures. So when I have a director, I'll send them like a mini treatment.
Understood.
Yeah. So I'll send like a little document over with here's pictures for this scene. I want this scene to start like this. I break all this shit down for them.
How important is the creativity for you though?
It's very important, bro. Very important. I mean, 99%, but a good percentage of this is creativity, right?
Whether for sure.
Creatively on making the music or mm-hmm. creatively visually. So it's always, I'm always trying to think of how to be creative and sometimes how to not to be too creative.
Understood. And I asked that to get back into the visuals. How important is it to add visual placement to a record?
It's super, super, super important, especially now.
Man.
Shit's content driven, we know that. Like, mm-hmm. we swipe through our phones and see content every single day, all day. This is content, you know what I'm saying? Like, so visuals are definitely important, you know, and a way around it. But of course, nowadays it's turning from maybe longer content to shorter content, and people are digesting things a little different, but.
Attention span.
Yeah, but I still believe in music videos. I still believe in shit, being creative, and I'm gonna push that until.
Then I think content has been in such control lately that now, again, where we're understanding it, that intent is coming back around. Nostalgia is coming back around. Purpose is coming back around. Like you said, not just how you said it, understanding when to kind of be crazy and when not to be crazy with a visual.
Yeah.
You know? And just like how you said, well, not even necessarily how you said, but how he said it to how you broke it down. I'm sure me telling somebody I want a naked lady on there with sushi sounds crazy to, instead of me breaking it down to how you visually, again, the nostalgia to that.
Yeah.
Again, when you say it out loud like that, it sounds, and you can visualize it so many ways, but it was very, very, very tasteful, very sexy.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, this coming off your head.
Yeah.
That's heavy.
Yeah, bro. I was blessed to do that. You know what I'm saying?
Go check it out. Real
yeah,
shit.
Expensive emotions. That's what
expensive
the video called.
Emotions.
Yeah, expensive emotions.
Was there? Let's come a little more present day before we kind of leave the music and get to talking a little shit.
Okay.
What does Def Jam come about?
So,
And I know he ain't drinking, but we're gonna toast to that. This is still, you know, very, very new and something you should definitely be appreciative. And we again appreciate your time as far as just giving us your time. As far
as I appreciate y'all, bro.
Not real deal.
It's family forever, bro.
Hey, I hope you need
y'all are family. Man. You know what I'm saying? Y'all are my family. I take this shit serious.
We stand from the whole
man,
Dallas.
What? We are not. This family shit is important to me, bro. Like, I want to know y'all families. I want to know what y'all do. I want to get on the road and goddamn send y'all packages. Like, you know? I want all that. I take this shit serious.
Hey, he's sitting on camera, so don't forget he said that.
Oh, I said, hey, my team is going to, bro, facts. You know what I'm saying?
But no, real deal. What was that, what would you say that project, or how does that come about?
Yeah, so I'll take you kind of through the journey. So I was about to sign a deal with Roc Nation. That was in 2020 or some shit like that.
I'm still.
I dropped the song. They liked the song. Oh, no, that's a lie. I dropped the song. Label started hitting me, which was cool. But then this dude from Roc Nation, his name is Earl. Shout out Earl. Earl went live on Instagram. And because COVID had just kind of started a little bit.
Understood.
So he started going to live, you know what I'm saying? And hear other artists, you know what I'm saying? So I tuned into Earl's live and I played him a song. He was like, yo, you're hard. Who is this? Like, and it was hella A&Rs, hella managers in the live, like, you know, waiting to find somebody.
Yeah.
So people start hitting me, boom, boom, everybody hitting me. And Earl was like, yo, I want to hop on a call with you, like, let's talk. Then I remember this dude, his name was, damn, what's bro name? Ethan. Ethan, shout out Ethan from Roc Nation. Ethan hit me up like, yo, let's hop on a call ASAP. Hop on a call with Ethan. We just talking. He was like, yo, like, we want to sign you. Like, we want to do this. I want to introduce you to the management side. Because we want to sign you on the management side of Roc Nation and the label side of Roc Nation.
Understood.
Then we want to make you, I was going to be the first artist signing both sides. There's no artist signing both sides. I'm like, let's do it. You know what I'm saying?
Can you repeat that one time for the listener?
I was going to be the first artist signed on the label side and the management side. Because every artist is signed to either the label side or the manager side.
Understood.
So I was going to do both. So they introduced me to the manager side. We was talking, da da da. And then COVID hit, boom, harder. And they hit me up like, yo, we don't have the funds anymore.
Understood.
We can't sign you. They took the deal off the table. My mom is blowing me up right now.
You need to take a call?
I'm doing an interview right now. Let me call you back. I'm going to call you back.
Mama's not playing
for real. She trying.
Hey, my mom is so important. I had to take that.
Nah, really?
Yeah, I'm sorry. She will blow my phone up.
Shout out
to my mom.
The whole time we seen it,
I'm like, bro, what are you calling for? So after the Roc Nation thing, they didn't sign me. They took my deal off the table. I'm like, fuck, what do I do now? You know what I'm saying?
How was that though? How
bro,
was that
heartbreaking.
That's heavy.
What? Bro, think about you about to sign to Jay-Z's label.
That's heavy.
And you like, nigga, we from Dallas. You know what I'm saying? Like, niggas don't come across that. Like,
nah,
what?
Sure.
You know, I'm in the hills with the management team and I'm 40K in debt, bro. So
in your mind, you like, I need this. This is the moment.
I need this. This got a hit.
So what happens?
So people still was going live, and this dude named Dro.
Mm-hmm.
Dro. Shout out Dro, man. Dro's an amazing person. So Dro is an A&R.
I think that's who I've been in contact with.
I think so, maybe.
Okay, shout out Dro. I think so.
Yeah.
And shout out Gutter. And shout out Jumpman from Iron Records.
Yeah, bro. Shout out Gutter.
Big love.
I wouldn't be here if it weren't for Gutter. Shout out Gutter. I'm here right now. Thank you, Gutter.
Love.
But yeah, Dro was going live. He's an A&R Def Jam. He was going live and shit too. So hopped on Dro live. Played the music. It's crazy. Hopping on live. Like, who, you know what I'm saying? Hopped on Dro live. Played the music. He was like, yo, I want to talk. I want to help. So Joe's like, we hopped on a call. He was like, bro, I don't know what it is, but I want to help you. So time went by. Me and Joe just stayed in contact, you know what I'm saying? And Joe hit me like, yo, I have this idea of this other label that I want you to sign with them.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, who? He's like, they from Dallas.
One of us out, please.
I know that wasn't true. They called the police either.
Rolling.
Yeah.
Let's get back to it. I apologize for being.
Hey, you know.
Yeah. So how's that journey? Like, After The Rock, after that.
Yeah. So
now you was on live.
Yeah, I was live with Joe. Joe loved the music. He was like, "Yo, I want you to sign to this label out of Dallas." And I'm like, "No, I'm in LA right at this point. I don't know nobody in Dallas. Like, I just left Dallas. Like, no."
Absolutely.
He was like, "No, trust me. Like, these, they from Dallas. They understand what you come from. They understand your journey, and they about to do some big things."
What you thinking beyond this?
I'm thinking Roc Nation. I'm still on that.
Absolutely.
I'm still trying to hit them up on some, like, "Yo, like, what we need to do?" You know what I'm saying?
Congrats, so, good, clean.
Man, what?
Something.
So Joe's really like, "Bro, like, trust me. Like, these are the people you need to sign with." I'm like, "Dro, I don't know, bro." Like, he's like, "Just hit me out. Like, just hop on a call with him, talk to him, da da da." So hopped on a call with this guy. His name is Jay. J Dot. Shout out High Standards. J Dot got on a call. I like J Dot's vibe. And Dro's my guy.
Mm-hmm.
And at Joe, at this time, Joe was kind of like managing me. You know what I'm saying?
Absolutely.
And I was like, "You know what, Dro? I'm gonna do this for you." Like, I knew Dro wouldn't steer me in the wrong direction. Cause I didn't really know too much about High Standards. I knew they had one artist at the time, Bobby Sessions. Y'all know who he is?
Absolutely.
Incredible artist in Dallas.
Shout out Bobby.
Man, shout out Bobby, bro. Super incredible artist. So I knew about Bobby, and I was like, "Man, I don't know, bro. Like, Dro, what should I do?" He's like, "Bro, trust me, sign with them." So I signed with them.
Mm-hmm.
It was crazy. It was crazy. I had this lawyer tell me. I had a lawyer at the time. I had Roc Nation's lawyer. They gave me a lawyer from some company, whatever.
So I
told the lawyer, "I'm about to sign to this indie label in Dallas," and I sent him the, you know, just the contract and stuff like that. And he was like, "Yo, don't sign this. I won't work with you if you sign this." And I'm like, "Why?" He's like, "This is not a good look. Don't do it. This is horrible." And I'm like, "Damn." But I trusted Dro. You know what I'm saying? I trusted Dro. So I'm like, "Bro, I don't know this lawyer. Who cares?"
Right.
So I said, "Screw it. Signed it anyways. Sent the lawyer about his business. He gone." And it came out, this is one of the biggest lawyer firms out there. And you know what I'm saying?
Was there something in specific he told you that?
He was just like, "This is stupid. Don't do it."
Understood.
And he told me I was going to end up like Meg Thee Stallion or something like that.
Mm.
That's what he said.
And who'd you end up listening to?
Dro. Listen to Dro. I trusted Dro. I don't care about no lawyer and fancy suits and all that. Whatever.
Understood.
You know what I'm saying? Who cares? You know what I'm saying? So I listened to Dro. And so I signed the High Standards. Best decision I ever made.
Talk that.
Best decision I ever made.
Talk that.
This is my family. Like, this is my family.
To this day.
Bruh. Right. This is the hottest. High Standards is the hottest label. I don't even want to say in Dallas. In the country.
Come on, man.
Like.
I trusted
that off just faith.
Shout out to Dro.
Shout out to Dro, man. Jay-Dot. And shout out to Jay. Shout out to J-Dot. Man. So, J-Dot, you know, I signed with them for like a year, just hoping.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm calling, you know, I'm eager, so I'm calling him like, "Dang, bro, nothing happened yet. Like, bro, maybe I messed up. Maybe I shouldn't have signed. I should have listened to the lawyer."
Yeah.
Jay hit me one day. I was still in L.A. He like, "Yo, I just signed a joint venture with Def Jam. They want to sign you."
Hmm.
Because I took a risk, bro. I took a risk for little of nothing.
Hmm.
Nothing, bro. And he's like, "Def Jam want to sign you. We just signed a joint venture. It's about to get crazy."
Can I phrase right quick? Because I got a question. Because you said you took a risk.
Took a risk.
Was that thinking end of you? Or was the risk just based off of emotions?
Man, I just feel like sometimes you just got to take it, bro. Like, you know, we all sometimes try to sit back with our parachute and never just jump.
Play it safe.
Yeah, play it safe. And you got your parachute. Yeah, you up there. It's cool. But, you know, down there, it's a whole, you know, it's a whole world down there that you stand up there. You stand in your little world.
It's a bigger
world down there. You just jumped. You had your parachute. You know what I'm saying? So I jumped with my parachute, and I didn't know how to work the parachute. I was falling.
Not really.
But then shit, nigga just floated right to the bottom. You know what I'm saying?
Running.
That's heavy, bro.
Took off from there, and High Standards, like, yeah, they changed my life. So now it's crazy because once I signed, it was just me and Bobby at that time. Now they got Coco Jones.
Talk to him.
So I don't know if y'all know who Coco Jones
Absolutely.
Is.
Absolutely, man.
On, one of the hottest R&B artists
right now, my boy.
And she's.
They added her to, if I'm not mistaken, the Essence Fest. She was kind of like the.
I think so.
She was.
So.
They brought her to kind of add that to the youth.
So yes.
They brought her,
yes.
her that fresh new face, and like you said, I mean, hottest one.
Hottest, yes. I see you was killing the game right now.
Man, super.
They signed Lady London, out of New York, fire artist.
Man.
So it's Naz, me, Bobby, it's Lady, it's Coco.
Let's jump in.
Can we talk a little shit right quick?
Yeah.
I mean, talk real big shit. Let me move this ice. I want to talk some shit right quick.
Okay, yeah.
I mean, what we got sitting on the wrist?
Oh, this, Cartier. You know, this bracelet was a gift for my mom, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, yeah.
What about the family forever? We went real heavy.
Yeah. Man, I had to stamp it.
Absolutely.
You know, I had to stamp it.
Tell us about the family forever.
Bro, my whole career, everything is based on family. Mm. Like, you see, I just asked a call from my mom in mid-interview.
Nah, bro,
like, facts, you know what I'm saying? Like,
she wasn't gonna stop.
Yeah, she wasn't gonna stop. Real I take tough. Family serious, bro, from my mom, my stepdad, my little brothers, my little sister, like, they all look up to me. You know what I'm saying? I'm the oldest. So my family is so important, bro. And even outside of my family, high standards, that's my family. Like, I rep them forever, no matter what. Like, they took a chance on me. I'm forever grateful, you know what I'm saying? For every artist, Bobby, Coco, whoever want me to do anything, I'm there, you know what I'm saying?
Question, you had said something off camera that you got to say, you got to get that knowledge on camera.
Mm-hmm.
I want to get into the LA, going out to LA, but you said collecting information to bring back home was important.
Sure.
Let's get into that.
Yeah, I mean, I moved to LA, lived there for 6 years, you know what I'm saying? And it's dope. I built relationships that I couldn't take away, you can't take away. I was in rooms that you can't get in anywhere else in the world, you know what I'm saying? So it was definitely so important that I lived there. It was a part of my journey.
Right.
And I would tell any artist to go there and be there a lot. If you don't live, be there a lot.
Understood.
You know, it's one of the only places besides like New York that got all the labels there. You know what I'm saying? So ain't no telling who you and me. But it's so important to come back to where you're from. And that's what I did. I had to come back home. Like, the LA, it's cool, don't get me wrong. And I knew my goal. And, I got back to Dallas, bro.
Tell us, because like you said, LA is one of those places where you go to the corner store, it could be
break the foot.
Give me one of the moments.
Oh, bro.
Yeah, I know.
So many.
Give me just one. Give me something, yeah, just and
fuck you. You was like, what the fuck?
And when we say Drake, you could be, yeah.
So many.
Just that one, though. It gotta be one where you were like, this is where the fuck I need to be.
You ran into him and continued the day with him.
Bro, so many. But I'm just saying, being in that position. First situation, and I kind of, you know, I've told people this about this before. When I first, the first day, I got to LA. My first song was called Superficial. And I worked this producer out of Amsterdam. He was like, yo, pull up to this crib. Like, let's work there. I pull up. I'm going through gates. I'm like, damn, where the fuck am I at? I'm from Dallas. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm in the hills with gates and shit. I'm like, what the fuck? So, I'm going through gates. And I pull up to this mansion. There's McLaren's outside. I'm like, where am I at? Like, this is insane. And I come through the door. And there's Beastie Boy plaques on the wall. I'm like, fuck Beastie Boys. And I look, and it was John Stamos' house. My first song I recorded in LA was at John Stamos' house.
Mm. With the Olsen twins?
Yes, bro. John Stamos.
With the slick band. With the
Jesse. You know what I'm saying?
Uncle Jesse.
Uncle Jesse.
Uncle Jesse.
So that was just crazy. That was like my first day. I'm like, oh, this is, come on, it's a no brainer. And there I met my first billionaire. I've never been a billionaire in my life.
What you mean?
Like,
I get what you mean, but.
When I got there, the billionaire was just like, his name was Adam, I think. Adam was like, yo, like, you're an artist? I'm like, yeah. He's like, dude, I have a yacht coming tomorrow. I'm like, what the fuck? Bro.
Nigga, I know you.
I got expressed enough. I am from Dallas, bro.
I know you. Like, you from Dallas. I know you.
Like, oh, God. So I'm
but
like,
listen, you like, that dude on.
I'm like, nigga, like, come to
the yacht. Oh, God, I win.
This nigga the police.
But I'm like, bro, what the, what? Come to the yacht. You're like, yacht guy. He said, come to the yacht, man. I would love to have you. It's going to be women, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, all right. And he just talking.
Nigga, I'm from Dallas.
Nigga, next day, I hit the nigga, hey, what's up? Like, what's good? Nigga, like, yo, here's the address. He sends it. I pull up to the address. Nigga, it's a yacht with just number of white people, number of white women.
Hmm.
I'm on the yacht. I'm the only black nigga on the yacht. Confused. And, bro, the whole time I'm there,
What you doing?
I couldn't even focus on the women or anything else. I was just so focused on the billionaire. I wanted to know how, why he talked like that, why he walked like that. I was looking at this, this
game.
Nigga, what? I was, bro was texting. I'm over his shoulder, looking through his phone, just to see, like, who he talking to. This you know what I'm saying? This is what it take, bro. So, and every time he talked to somebody, I would just listen. And I'm just trying to figure out how he made, because he never said what he do, you know what I'm saying? So I'm like, what he do, you know? So he was talking to somebody about, he was like, yeah, I got lots. He kept saying lots, and he kept saying, like, yeah, it's like, I got like 700 on this lot. So I really don't understand at that time, but I think as time went by, I think he was talking about hotels. Like, he had hotels on land. So I figured that's maybe that's how he made, you know, that much money. But
absolutely.
Yeah, so I had to really just understand that, bro, and I'm glad I was just listening and became a sponge. And that was the first situation. Second situation, so I interned at Atlantic Records when I first moved to L.A.
Mm-hmm. That's heavy.
You trying to get that music anyway,
bro? I was, nigga, what? Bro, I was working at the post office from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m., right? I would go to my internship from 7 p.m. to 3 a.m. Get back home, shower, take a little 3-hour, 4-hour nap, back at work. This is my life, bro.
Niggas ain't built like that.
They not.
Niggas not.
And that's how I know, bro. These young niggas and niggas I heard, they don't really want it. They just think, I'm gonna drop a song, TikTok, blah, 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 viral, whatever the case may be. Bro, I was interning. I was going to get food for niggas. I was cleaning studios. You know how your ego, like a nigga say, go get my food. You know how you gotta like just, cause I'm an artist, bro. So I'm like, damn, nigga just told me to go get his food. Like, and he ain't saying it in no like nice way.
He's
go get my food. I need some food. You know, so I'm like, damn, like, all right, what you want? And I learned now, like, I was just in the studio the other day in L.A. An intern asked me that I want some food. And I was like, yeah, you want something, bro? I'll buy you something. Like, what you want?
Because you know how it is.
Because I knew how it was, bro. Niggas was telling me to go get some food.
That's
I said, bro, I'll buy you food. Like, what you want, bro? You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm treating everybody like family. Like,
absolutely.
This shit is real to me.
It's like you got that big ass.
This one, I want it to be big as possible.
You trying to shift the paradigm.
Shift it, bro.
Absolutely.
You ain't no intern. You part of this studio session.
Not real
what
good.
You want? We're going to get food for everybody.
You got to like, see it to be.
Yeah, come on, man. So.
The energy you giving out is just. It's coming back now, right?
But,
it's
coming back.
But and listening to you, like you said, and I know we mentioned thinking, but bro, and I know we spoke successful
somebody,
habits,
somebody
but bro, yeah, but this knowledge, yeah, that you have instilled, again, it's either just literally within you, bro, or again, it's for a higher purpose.
I hope so. Higher purpose. Got to be for a higher purpose.
Nah, real deal.
It is.
Yeah.
You it is. You could have easily left this motherfucker and never came back to
facts.
Where do we lack? Going to L.A., seeing the system, coming back home, being from home, where do we lack?
Where do we lack?
Absolutely. Yes. We don't want the pretty shit. Where do we lack?
We don't lack talent. Talent's here.
It's not enough.
Facts.
Definitely.
We don't lack platforms. They're here.
Mm-hmm.
We lack labels.
Uh-huh.
There's not many labels here. High standards is probably one of the main ones.
Understood.
Right? They really understand this game. It's not mean there's no labels. Well, man, there's labels, maybe like a couple indie labels, but there's no major labels here. LA, New York, even got labels in Atlanta, like Love Renaissance. I'm like, they're not a major label, but you got people that's labels that's there, right?
Right.
You don't have no labels here,
mm-hmm.
No A&Rs really. And if they are here, they're not, you don't know too much, you know what I'm saying? And you don't have too many people investing in the music, like Carl Crawford. So I guess it's a label.
Mm-hmm.
So like, where's the football players that want to start a label in Dallas?
Talk this shit.
There's Dallas Mavericks people here. I mean, not Dallas Mavericks, Dallas Cowboys. Where's the Dallas Mavericks player that wants to?
Texas Rangers.
Where's the Texas Rangers? We have three different teams here. You got Paul Crawford that played baseball. He said, I'm going to start a label in Houston. If we had those things, we're out of here. Well, talent, the artists themselves, the creators themselves, they're here. Facts. The businesses are here. We just need all the other stuff. So. Yeah.
Before we leave the music, I mean, give a consumer, even myself, because I always say I'm a student of life.
Mm.
Along this journey, what's a piece of information that you could provide for a young artist, a young entrepreneur, you know, to keep with self?
To keep with self?
Absolutely.
I mean, I don't even want to say the, of course y'all know my slogan, plan your work your plan will work.
Mm-hmm.
I live by that, die by that, you know what I'm saying? I'm gonna say something different this time. I feel like Just I don't even know how to say this I'm not gonna say this in an intellectual way, but nah, this is how my mind thinking.
Tell them nigga.
Bro, I think, and when I say quantity, it take 1,000 no's for 1 yes, bro. I'm point blank. And I live by that. Whether it's applying for a job, you know, I used to apply for jobs and I put in 3,000 applications just to get 1 yes.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? Or I make 100 songs to get one good one. You know what I'm saying? So just doing that, like whether that's with anything, whether it's doing 100,000 videos to get that one video.
Absolutely.
1,000 pieces of content, get that one piece of content.
Stick with it.
Sticking with that.
And because the reason why I ask, because I like, and I, to give me something for the consumer, because I feel like you said, we don't lack the talent. Me and him were having a conversation. I think we just lack the back end as far as being taking initiative and being innovative with our product. Mm. Like you said, everyone just wants to drop and release. Hopefully, I blow up tomorrow. For 1% of that may work, but for the majority, that's not realistic.
Right. It makes me mad when people think that, bro, because it's like, and I come across artists all the time, like, bro, I'm about to shoot this video, I'm about to drop, da da da. I'm like, bro, you don't even get it. Like, bro, I had to intern. I had to take people food to them.
And
like, come on,
y'all. What I'm saying, because I'm really listening to you, what I'm saying and what he's saying, I don't even know if you realize you're saying it, but I think you'll understand why I said you have to use other. Yeah, get off social media. Utilize the platform, but yes. You have to place your product and your product being yourself in front of people.
In their face, bro. Yeah. And people gonna maneuver if you got good character. Like,
absolutely.
It takes in person. The social media stuff cool. Don't get me wrong, but I'm hearing y'all face right now. Like, no, meeting y'all personally. You know what I'm saying? Like, I want y'all to rock with me.
Not really.
The music, all that, whatever, that's cool. You know what I'm saying?
By yourself.
You know what I mean? Like, by myself. Real nobody shit. With me. So,
real talk.
That's important to me. And not to jump out of pocket.
No, you're good.
Because I was thinking about it.
No, you're good.
The intern thing in Atlanta. I mean, at Atlantic. Just to go back to what you said. The other instance with how did I know?
Oh, yeah.
This is
crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah, go be so, please.
I was in studio and there was it was me, DeAndre Hopkins, football player, Ty Gurley.
Nigga just went with the Titans. Go ahead, though.
This nigga named Demarius Randall, I think. Mm-hmm. And this other nigga named Quan Alexander at the time. All NFL
players. In the league.
They like, yo, like, we like what y'all doing in the studio. Like, we want to make songs.
Hmm.
I'm probably the only artist that I got a song with Ty Gurley, DeAndre Hopkins.
This nigga finna make me
Quan
jump.
Alexander. Nigga, I was trying to get on Madden, nigga. I was like, I'm telling Madden, like, nigga, I got to sell with y'all players.
No,
like,
man,
who has that?
Reaching out.
Come on, bro.
I still got it.
Madden, hit me up, bro. Yeah. I got the song with Ty Gurley, DeAndre Hopkins, man. We
it's
still
on
got
ice.
It.
It's all ice,
no,
man.
Yeah, that's
it's
heavy,
no
though. Cost,
come on,
man. That's heavy.
Come on. So, yeah, that was just a crazy out of.
What's, can we get the hook?
I don't even remember. It was a long time ago. But, hey, Madden, let me know, man.
Let's go talk to the other end, because Mac was bringing up something. Mac was bringing up the ladies, man. I mean, slow it down. I mean, you single, correct?
Yeah.
What kind of ladies are we into?
Just beautiful women inside. Inside.
I love that.
Yeah.
Rich.
I mean, it's beautiful women everywhere in the world.
We got to get more in depth for them, because considering yourself a high-profile man.
Yeah.
Pretty can't just be enough.
No, not enough.
Talk to him.
Bro, I meet pretty girls all the time, and with my life, I just need somebody that's an asset, not a liability, bro. Mm-hmm. So I need help with certain things in my life. Not like helping me, but assistance in, if I'm doing this business, I need you to, you know, you might have to do this business, or we need to be level. A structured partnership, but level, you know what I'm saying? I don't care if you're bad, like, if you beautiful, whatever, super beautiful, and, you know, I care about how you are inside.
Absolutely.
Like, you know, I care about effort. I care about, you know, treating your man with respect. I'm a man. I ain't no little boy. Like, I don't know. I ain't.
Do you come across that a lot?
For sure.
Okay.
For sure. You know?
Did he say I'm 10 toes down, even if I had 9 or some shit?
On God.
Is that what
you're saying? On God.
He said I'm 10 toes down, even if I got 9 toes.
Nah, yeah, damn. Yeah, damn. But yeah, that goes, but again, are you one?
Do I need one woman? Yeah. Ultimately, yeah, I need one woman. But you know, the vibes, you know.
No, I don't know. I need you to explain.
Oh, yeah, the vibes, you know. We can do two. We can do three. You know what I'm saying? But ultimately,
for sure,
you know, for sure, one woman.
Yeah, and I ask that because again, a lot of us, especially in these days, we are starting to understand again polygamy.
Polygamy. Yeah, yeah.
I understand that we have.
Are you sharing your wife?
Would I share my wife?
Just a, it's
like
a,
Adam 22.
You know, hell no. No, that's crazy. Listen, I'm a man, man. We ain't doing that. You don't know.
Throw it out, man.
Would you?
No. Definitely no.
He said, hey, you know, hey. Yeah, no. Nah, we ain't
$1 million, they can't wax y'all.
Nah, never.
They can't wax mine neither.
And I think what he's saying never. Is like,
no, real deal.
It can't be based on money.
It can't. Money come and go. Money come and go. I tell girls that every day. Even if you with me because of money, you're dumb. Because I can get broke tomorrow.
Right when you said the inner. Because like a woman could be beautiful.
I feel
just like
if you come
any my man. After two or three kids and 40, 50.
The beauty changes. So, or if I'm seeing you every single day. It's like eating papados. I love papados. Mm-hmm. Every day?
Not really.
It's looking like, you know, papados. They look like papados. They look like, you know, a catfish spot. Like Tipitos, you know what I'm saying? Like, so it's like, shit.
Now I say that because I think the younger generation, bro, is kind of just like
money driven.
Yeah, it's social media, but
absolutely.
Yeah, I need a beautiful woman. Inside.
And even with women don't understand, even if your hustle is to get money, I feel like if that's your direct intent, you gonna get less money coming directly for that.
And I need, you know, like, and I'm gonna throw this out there. You know, I got businesses and things like that.
Talk to
and with the businesses I have, you have to be a beautiful person inside.
Hmm.
My business is not even set up where if you're like just this outer person and you're not a beautiful person inside, it wouldn't work. You know, it wouldn't work.
Hold on, you move around the world, like, and I know you say the beautiful inside, like, what's that number one when you meet these women where you just like,
bruh. Can't do it.
Yeah, just like that number one where you just like,
ew.
Is it the phone? Is it the, I got, is it?
Yeah, there's so much going on.
Is it just that one where you just like,
It's a couple things. It's a couple things.
I like the shade room conversation.
Give me some news we could use.
If you just, just how you talk, like, if you only talking about yourself.
Yeah, I like that.
I don't really rock with it, you know? Or if you just real, like,
you know, talking to herself like a third person.
Like, type shit, like, or if you just real, like, short answered. You know, I don't know. I like personality. I want you to laugh.
No doubt.
I want you to be goofy. Like,
yeah.
I don't
want to
know. Be yourself, bro. Yeah. Yeah. So, and like I said, beautiful inside, bro. Because, yeah.
Shit, like, leave.
Man, it's so important. So important. Especially with the business that I have, bro, you have to be.
Absolutely.
I ain't talking about even music. Other.
What businesses you want?
Give us some knowledge. I mean, it's a business move podcast.
It's the business move.
You got to
talk about the business thing.
You got to talk to business. I mean, what you got your hands in?
I own a foster agency. Yeah, people don't know that. I'm giving y'all the sauce right now.
Please.
I own a foster agency, bro. I'm the youngest owner in the country.
You
I hope you niggas
back.
Listen.
Man, what?
You won't get back.
Hold on. What's the direction of that?
Like, what you mean?
How do you, you just said, you the youngest owner. Two, again, not that I'm just in network with the world, but I do know a few different people here and there, and I've never heard this conversation.
I never.
Nah, but back into it, bro. Like I said, that's heavy, bro. Like, as I was saying, nigga gonna buy some trucks, nigga gonna buy some stocks, but going to buy a foster home. I mean,
I did trucks for a year, and it was not. So when I was living in LA, I had a trucking business for a year, like three trucks. It went cool. I learned a lot. You know, I had employees and, you know, it was cool. But I had to wake up at 4 a.m. every day because I lived in LA and 6 a.m. here. Mm. And it kind of went down here and I sold the company. And yeah, I don't have anything.
Can I guess why though?
Huh? So this is my step. Yeah.
Now,
can
come
I guess?
On,
but can I guess why though?
Why?
Me listen to like you going from trucks to foster home, because not I'm sure if you wanted you could have made your trucking company successful.
Facts.
The intention.
Mm-hmm.
The intention didn't match for you.
It didn't match. It wasn't the same. That was different. It was different.
And that leads into us going to get the foster home.
Mm-hmm.
Like, elaborate on that for us. I mean,
is that passion?
Yeah, passion too. And I've been around it for so long. You know what I'm saying? Like my mom had a foster agency for like four or five years or something like that. My little brother, he was adopted.
Understood.
You know what I'm saying? My aunt passed when I was like a sophomore in college. Mm-hmm. Right? Her two kids were adopted.
Understood.
And my cousins. My aunt got in a car wreck, and I haven't seen my cousin since. The system took them after that. That's crazy it. Situation. So I kind of always been around that world. And like my whole goal is always to just help the youth, even with music or just
life.
You know what I'm saying? And this was just right in front of me.
Big homie, you have five. I got four. So I mean, like you said, youth. I mean, our children. How important is that program? And that program, I mean, as far as the youth and passing this knowledge, coming back home, going to get a foster agency.
Mm-hmm. It's important. So important. I mean, I had my first son. My son might be one. You know what I'm saying?
Congrats. Blessings.
But even with the foster agency, I'm responsible for all these kids. So I'm dad to many more kids.
Absolutely.
You know what I'm saying? They come to me, Trey, what should I do with this? They get in arguments. They get in fights. They run away, they don't run away.
How that make you feel though? Like being able, or it sounds like you always wanted to be that.
Yeah, I'm blessed, bro. Blessed to be able to just give them, you know, a different perspective. Because, bro, with foster agency, it'd be an old white person trying to give you some, you know, preach to you.
Yeah.
It's like, they don't want to hear that. They ain't trying to hear that, you know.
You from there, so I can.
You see what I'm saying? They relate to me. I don't know. Whatever you want to do sports, you want to do this, you want to do that, I've done it. So they listen to me out of anybody. You know what I'm saying? And it's so impactful coming from a different type of person.
Especially someone they can relate with.
Exactly. So, yeah, I became a dad to many kids.
For sure. Tell me, because you said no drinking, no smoking.
Mm-mm.
I know you fly in the motherfucker. What's your shit? What is Trey gonna spend his money on?
Or
his enjoyment on? What is that drug for you in the
traveling?
Traveling?
Yeah, I like
that's beautiful.
I just got from Miami yesterday.
Yesterday?
At midnight. Yeah.
Had a trip. Hold on. Rolling Loud?
I didn't go to Rolling Loud. But
the vibe was there.
It was crazy, yeah. I booked my flight 2 hours before the flight left. Like, just went out there. It was my birthday.
Yeah.
My birthday just passed. You know what I'm saying? So.
Late happy birthday.
Hold on. You a Cancer?
Leo.
Okay. But hold on, bro. We went to Miami. We Trey Haggerty.
Mm-hmm.
Birthday just passed. Mm. Can you give us a night?
The night? What happened out there in Miami?
Give me a night. A night.
A night? A night in Miami or?
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't too crazy.
Nah, okay. I was just trying to catch a vibe with you right quick.
It was cool. It was just regular shit, but to be honest, I was just ready to get back.
Honestly.
Because I missed some things here with my kids, foster kids and stuff like that. So I was more worried about that.
And it's home based everything.
Yeah. For facts.
Where your favorite place to visit?
I went to Costa Rica. Costa Rica was beautiful.
Yeah.
Like amazing. Yeah.
Speak Spanish any?
Nah.
No? Okay.
I wish. So yeah, Costa Rica was beautiful. Super beautiful.
Outside of that, I mean, any interest as far as fashion? I mean, what we wearing these days? If we hit the we're in Dallas, right? We going to Gallery or North Park?
Well, you thugging in the white tee.
Nah, Foot Locker.
I'm seeing
about
that.
We're going to Foot Locker. We're going to
win.
We getting the white tee.
Talk to him.
We going to party. Get a white tee.
Talk
to him.
Talk to him.
I mean, we grew up off North Park and Galleria. I grew up off Redbird. You know what I'm saying?
Talk to him.
Or Redbird.
Talk to him.
Redbird just got remodeled. So don't get it.
I might tap in. You know what I'm saying?
What? Come on.
Hold on, listen to you just like your journey and everything before we, you know what I'm saying? But you really got a passion for like helping other people.
Yes, that's my passion.
Is other than traveling, is that the thing that you just like?
Yes.
I got
that moves you?
Yes, I love to give back. I love to give people just my experience because I guess I done so many things from engineering, which is like business, suit and tie shit, you know what I'm saying? Or sports. I play college football.
Yeah.
Music. I'm doing this at the highest level. Businesses. I done did that. I had a trucking business. I got a foster agency.
Right.
All these different things I've done. So it's like when people come to me, I'm like, bro, how do I do this? Or whatever case may be, I'm able to just give back knowledge.
Genuine knowledge.
Absolutely.
And just give back to my community. Like, for example, I'm doing an event August. Come, please. August 13th.
We're there.
August 13th. I would love to have y'all there.
You got a name for the event?
Yeah, it's called Family Forever Bash.
We'll be there. Family Forever Bash.
Bro, I got 97.9 coming.
Talk to her.
It's in Cedar Hill. So, you know, a lot of people rush back to South Dallas, Oak Cliffs, to East Dallas to try to give back. But I wanted to do something for the communities that, you know, we come from, and people think that we got money or something like that. You know what I'm saying? Like Duncanville, Lancaster.
Yeah.
Like, we just as poverty driven as Oak Cliff. You know what I'm saying? Like, I didn't have it growing up, so I know it's a lot of niggas in Duncanville right now that don't got it. You know what I'm saying? So I'm doing a whole back to school bash. I'm giving away over 300 backpacks and school supplies. I got.
We there.
We there. I got
me. And I say that to say, bro, because a lot of people don't give that positivity.
Man.
You know what I'm saying? Even when we came here and got on the bottle, I don't smoke, I don't drink. And it's like, are you doing that like to lead? Like, not even that, just in general, like lead by example.
Yes.
Show these people like,
yes, bro.
Bro, I'm from the same place.
You can do it.
Yeah.
Hmm. So even for this, like, I'm giving away school backpacks. I'm giving away supplies. I got exotic animals. I got a face painter. I got a Tarleton State coming to pass out brochures and sign people up for tours.
Yeah.
Dallas Behavioral Hospital, which is like a hospital my foster kids go to when they going through suicidal ideations. I got the radio station, 97.9 coming. I got the mayor of Cedar Hill coming.
That's heavy.
I got the mayor's number.
That's like, heavy, bro. That's heavy.
We texted. I'm like, bro.
That's heavy, bro.
He a black man. You know what I'm saying? Yes, got the mayor of Cedar Hill coming. I got the councilwoman.
That's heavy.
Councilwoman Daniels coming from Cedar Hill. Black woman.
Black
bro.
Is beautiful.
And we about to have over three.
Black is beautiful.
Bounce houses.
Black is beautiful.
Snow cone machines. All these different things.
I just wanted to give you that, bro, because like I am, you know, sipping a little bit, but I'm just listening and absorbing the game, right? And I'm just like, that's just what it is.
Yes.
Bro. That's what it's going to take to switch this, where we from.
Facts. This all came from my pocket. This ain't come from no labels. This ain't come from nothing. This just came from me saying, I don't got no sponsors for this event. I have none of that. Like, this is just me saying, hey, I'm going to put my money up, and I'm going to give back to the communities that people are not giving back to, and we're going to do it like that. It's going to be over 300 kids there. We're going to, you know.
305. I'm bringing my five.
Bring them on, bro. We're going to give backpacks to all of them. Oh, and we're giving away like shoes and stuff too, like Foot Locker gift cards and all type of stuff like that. So, it's gonna be crazy.
That was something as well, because again, I could imagine any other ventures outside of music. I mean, that you've done. Or, I mean,
yeah, besides the trumpet business.
Not even necessarily business. I mean, acting. Have you done any acting?
I want to.
Because the personality is there.
Yeah, I want to do acting. That's definitely a goal of mine. But I've just been more business driven.
Understood.
The business podcast.
Absolutely. Yeah, look,
super business driven. Just did trucks. I've done real estate. Like, I just bought some land the other day in Dallas. We're going to build on it and stuff like that. Of course, my main thing is my foster agency.
Understood.
One of the biggest agencies in Dallas. Like, bro, anything is possible. I can say this. People don't understand, bro. Let me just say this real quick. I don't even want to talk about.
Drop them gems. You said you're just
going to
drop
some gems.
Talk that.
2 years ago, bro, or a year and a half ago, two years ago, I was working a job, an engineering job, suit and tie. I got fired from my job for doing music, right? Literally. Like, they called me into the office and showed me my music video and was like, this is not acceptable. It had nothing to do with the job, but they didn't want me to do music, I guess.
Conflict of interest.
Type of shit, you know what I'm saying? Lost my job. In 2 years, bro, my life changed. I went from working a job to now, my business is a multi-million dollar business.
Talk that shit.
Easy. In 2 years, bro. And I've helped so many families and helped so many kids. And I can go where I want, do what I want, and I'm able to just give back. 2 years. So anybody listening, I don't care who you are, kids, not kids, in a year or 2 years, your whole life can change. Literally, I can show y'all, I took freaking videos of me leaving my job. Like, bro, I'm out this job. Bruh.
But why you preaching, bro, and why you passing that message off, bro? But again, we keep doing it, but it goes back to commending you, bro. Everybody not like that. And as I get older, that's been a fight that I've had, understanding that difference. But that's, Max said this before, that's just life paying you back.
Facts.
People,
so let me actually back up a little bit.
Like, that's life paying you back.
So I got fired for doing music for my first job. That was in L.A., right? I found out I was having a baby. This is me being transparent. So got fired from the job because I was doing music. Found out I was having a baby. And I'm like, yo, I got to go back to Dallas. And my label's already telling me, like, yo, this is before I got signed to Def Jam. they're like, yo, like, you need to get back to Dallas, like, get back to your people, you know what I'm saying? The LA stuff, cool, you've been there for a while, get back. I was like, this is the perfect time, I'm having a kid, I lost my job, I'm going back.
All right.
Moment I moved back, maybe like a month after I moved back, then I signed a Def Jam, right? Keep in mind, I've been staying in LA hoping to sign a deal, and I signed a deal as soon as I moved back to Dallas. Not in LA, in Dallas, you know what I'm saying? So I signed a deal, I'm still working my job, because I'm like, bro, I heard stories about rappers going broke. Like, I never want to be that. You know what I'm saying? So I get another job when I move to Dallas, another engineering job, right? I worked there. I'm working. And it came to a point where I had to go to a studio session in Houston. And I had to work. And I told my label, like, I can't go. I gotta go to work. You know what I'm saying? My label, like, you're choosing work over your session? I'm like, damn, you're right. So keep in mind, this time I had already started the agency. It's been like almost a year at this time. But I had no kids, I had no families, I had no nothing. I just started the process, and the process is long. You spend a lot of money. It's tiring. Like, it's a lot of stuff you gotta do.
Development.
Yeah. So I'm going through that whole process, and I'm at the point now where I'm losing money. I'm tapped out. I'm having a kid.
Right.
I'm barely getting by, etc. I keep. And this is God. This is how I know God is real. The day I quit, so I called my label. I'm like, bro, I'm just gonna quit and come to Houston. Forget it. Yeah. I got a son. I gotta figure it out. So I quit my job. I called my boss, said, I can't do this no more. Da, da, da. He's like, you gonna put it in 2 weeks? I'm like, no, I'm leaving now. I quit. It's crazy, bro, because it don't seem real.
No, listen,
it's like, I'm like, it don't seem real, bro. The minute I walk out, I get an email saying I placed my first kid. As soon as I quit, bro.
That's crazy. That's crazy, bro.
And after that, my foster agency went through the roof. Now I got like 20 families.
Now you doing what you love.
Not real.
Now you at home.
Not real.
Get to answer mom in the middle of the interview.
This is a multi-million dollar company that I'm running. So yeah,
took that risk. How was that risk?
I took. It was one of the right risk. One of the most life-changing things that ever, you know, I couldn't ask for a better risk, you know what I'm saying? I took it, God made a way for me, and I'm making a way for others, point blank.
Real deal.
That's easy as said, bro.
Real deal.
Real talk.
It's easy as said.
It's really beautiful just really speaking to you, bro, because again, this conversation I feel like is what needed. I didn't know what necessarily route would take, but again, kind of just to change that mindset, and there's other options we could take as far as than what we just see on the surface. Sometimes we got to separate ourselves to find what direction to go, and if we continue just moving through that experience of life, it'll come more clear, but it got to come with an intention.
Yes.
I think when you're attaching yourself to things with no meaning and a lesser value, that's when you find yourself in situations where at the end it seemed like, damn, my nigga was lost, because that's what a nigga was. But tell me something, man. July 29th, Earl Spence, man. We rocking with the home team, or we going across?
Oh, for sure. No. If
Spence?
Spence.
We got
I'm actually going out there to Vegas.
We got a prediction?
Maybe like.
That boy Crawford is dope. That's all I'm saying.
I think it'll go all the way to 12 rounds, but I think Spence will win it unanimous, you know, for sure.
So what you got going now, though, before we wrap it up,
what
trade you got going other than?
Of course, indecisive decisions.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
We got the Fredo Bang. We got the.
New record. Undivided attention.
My bad. Undecided.
Undivided.
Undivided attention.
Undivided attention right now.
I told you.
Undivided attention. Fredo Bang.
Freacher Fredo Bang. Yes.
Talk that shit.
Tap hands right now.
Help him eat so we can help. Feed other people.
Exactly.
But not talking
family. Feed the family.
How was that collab, though? I mean, was that an in-studio project?
We sent it to him. We felt the record was right for him. We wanted to, you know, get somebody that, you know, speak to the streets and speak to the people. And, you know, just also still speak to the women. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
It was great work with him.
Super sexy, you know, summer record.
Shot the video in Miami. Bro pulled up. Genuine dude. Also, I'm going on tour with him. Big August love. 18th. It's my first time announcing
talk
it.
Talk
August 18th, man. We on tour. 20 cities.
Talk that.
Dallas is one of them.
Talk that.
Come to the show.
We come.
Dallas, come to the show.
We
bro.
Coming.
I think Dallas is like October 14th.
I'll leave this nigga at home if you give me backstage.
We'll get you all that. Come to the show. Come to the show.
Tell me something before we wrap this up, man. Mm-hmm. Give me one last thing. I mean, where you at right now in present? What big homie always asks a question, but I'm gonna ask.
No, I always ask. What is what are you telling a 16-year-old Trey? What would you tell him? You know, just some insight of what you just been around and you done, and I'm just listening to the journey, bro. It's a beautiful journey. Yeah. And good things happen to good people. Yeah. But like, what you telling, or not even Trey, what you telling that young man at Duncanville, like, that's trying to go from here to there?
Figure out their route. Figure out what's next. How to make that step.
Trust God and lead with your heart. Mm. Everything else will follow.
Hey,
you know, if
you do something you love, you'll never work another day in your life.
Exactly. You leave with your heart, bro, it's going to work out. Like, that's what I live by. No matter what it is, no matter, I'm thinking about financials, blah, blah, blah. I'm going to leave with my heart first, and everything is going to come to it. You know what I'm saying?
Real talk.
Point blank.
Talk that. Hey, it's a Business Move podcast. It's Cliff.
Big homie, Matt. Trey, appreciate you coming in.
Man, I appreciate y'all for having me.
Appreciate
y'all for having me.
Absolutely.
We're getting better. Nah,
thank you, bro.
I know you don't.
Y'all don't. I'm gonna give it to my stepdad.
Man,
some shit.
Yeah,
for sure.